of admissibility of digital evidence in India. Yeah, so there is one important concept which actually was at during that time. I just, you know, I just didn't, I just, it just went, it just flew from my mind to cover. And today we are going to cover that. So, Indians Evidence Act. Yes, exactly. So, specifically, if you just want to say what specifically could be the Indians Evidence Act and what specifically we are going to talk about, anyone who could just mention. Giving you a hint, it is something that it, you know, whenever you are actually providing any digital evidence in the Indian court, without that, most of the times it is not admissible. It's a certificate. Anyone who knows the name? No, it's Sam sir, I think you won't even know it because this particular topic that we're going to cover, it is very specific towards geographic area of India and not other nations. It's very specific and relevant in terms of India only. Okay, so you can just take it as a GK, right? Because it's interesting to know about it. Or anyways, one day some other, if you get some case in India, yeah, you should know about it, right? So we are actually today understanding about the 65B certificate. Okay, and for this, see, one thing, on Edmodo, I don't know how many of you people are updated on the Edmodo. I mean updated in the sense, I don't know how many of you people actually look into Edmodo on a regular basis, but if someone of you could have these days in the, these 3 days could have logged it into Edmodo. Oops, sorry. In just a minute, I'll start sharing my screen. So, in Edmodo, you could have seen that there is something, few things added. And instead of, every time relying on those notes, yeah, see, notes are there, the notes that we are designing, right? You are checking regularly. That's cool, right? So apart from the notes, the PDF notes that we are giving, we had been saying that, we will be sharing references and also, right? So today's class, it's not something that we have created separate notes for it. There is a reference article on the web, and using the reference article itself, we are going to understand today's class. Because every time it's boring for me also to read notes, it's boring for you also to see the same PDF, right? So there should be some method changing patterns in terms of teaching methodologies, right? I'll go into folders. Well, actually, it should be in admissibility folder, but I think I have added into, let me just see where I've added dealing with digital evidence. Yeah, it should be over here itself. Yeah. This is involvement of, yeah, so this is the case studies. Yeah. And so see over here, section 65B and the admissibility. It's a reference link. Today's class and probably tomorrow's,
Super
we are going to understand this 65B only, wherein I doubt, I am not sure, I doubt that today's class may get winded early due to the fact that in the morning I'm going to get sample of 65B certificate, a reference. You can get easily on online also, but I want to show you a proper reference. So I don't have it currently. I'm not sure when I'm going to receive it, from my circle. I'm sure I'm going to get it max by tomorrow morning. So if I get it, or probably the today's class may end soon discussing about, or it may won't also because it's a long discussion about 65B. And understanding this 65B of the Indian Evidence Act and the certificate, it's a quite complex because it is something which it didn't came up into the constitution as it is when it was formed. It is something which was, you know, revamped again and again, over the debates and the clauses in some certain classic cases, very famous cases, Indian cases. In that, you know, these, you know, loopholes were observed and all, and statements and all were made, and on the basis of which today this 65B is actually present. It's not complex thing, but the history behind this is quite complex and may kind of get confusing to understand. But today, and probably tomorrow and day after, and not day after, but today and tomorrow, what will be our actual focus is to deeply understand, not just understand, but to deeply understand the history behind this. Okay, because it may be complex, but it's way interesting. And number two, to understand how you could actually write a 65B certificate and who can write 65B certificate. Okay, this will be the intention. So going further, so what it's all about, see, why didn't we choose to make notes? Because this is already written by advocates, right? So let's rely on those. Why to just, you know, add up own notes every time? So section 65B of the Indian Evidence Act 1872, requirement for the admissibility of the electronic evidence revisited by the Supreme Court. Let me just try to zoom in. I don't know why in Linux pinching the fingers doesn't zoom in. Anyways, let me know, is there a need to zoom in or this is enough? CMD plus, okay, so control plus. Oh, thanks a lot. So, see a background about it. A 3-judge bench of Supreme Court recently held that the requirement of certificate under section 65B4, subclause 4, of Indian Evidence Act 1862 is a condition precedent to the admissibility of the digital record in evidence. So it's directly dealing with the admissibility, right? So you can just understand how important it is because it's directly referring to the admissibility of the evidence. This judgment arose from a reference by a division bench of Supreme Court which found that the division bench judgment in Shafi Mohammed versus State of Himachal Pradesh. This basically is a case. Okay, this basically is a case. It's a case. A well, classic case. Okay, I just loaded up the same link. Sorry. Required by the reconsideration in the view of 3-judge bench judgment in Anwar versus Bashir case. This is also a case. I mean, just grab it as of now, whatever you can. Today, tomorrow, we have this entire 65B focus. I'll just, you know, apart from this article, today we'll just focus on this particular article because according to me, I just found this article on the web to be one of the most amazing article explaining the things in depth, right? Apart from that, still, I'm also going to explain you. Yet, the conceptual things will be different, but the overall technical things and the statemental things will be the same. Yeah, it's law language and it's way confusing. But once you understand it, it's way easy to grab. Now what is this admissibility of electronic record? The paper on which the information contained in electronic record is printed, or the optical image or magnetic media is produced by the computer in which such information is stored, recorded or copied, shall be admissible in any proceedings without proof of production of the original. As evidence of any contents of the original or any fact stated therein of which direct evidence would be admissible.
Please stop recording here.
Again, now just focus on this article over here. Where a statement in evidence is sought to be given in virtue of section 65B, section 65B subclause 4 This is very important. This is what deals with the certificate. The subclause 4 of the 65B. It requires a certificate to be produced that inter alia identifies the electronic record containing the statement and describes the manner in which it is produced and gives particular of the device involved in the production of the electronic record to show that the electronic record was actually produced by a computer, either by a person occupying responsible official position, such as you can say a forensic analyst, in relation to the operation of the relevant device or the management of the relevant activities, whichever is appropriate. Going a bit further in this, what actually it's all about, how does it, you know, just went ahead. Here, to understand this, certain understanding of these cases is important. To be very honest, till date, I myself also don't have much understanding of these cases, but a bit of understanding is required, not a deep dive. I'm not even saying, I also haven't done a deep dive on the cases. I'm not saying on the Evidence Act. This entire, whatever we are discussing today, tomorrow is quite important, at least in the geographic area of India.
Very important. We cannot highly provide recordings every day.
So, the earliest notable decision of Supreme Court in relation to the admissibility of electronic record is State versus Navjot Sindhu case, which held that irrespective of the compliance with the requirement of Section 65B, there is no bar to adduce secondary evidence under the Section 63 and 65 of an electronic record. This judgment was actually overruled by Supreme Court in Anwar. Okay. So here Anwar Supra, I mean, it's known as, held that Section 63 and 65 have no application to secondary evidence by way of electronic record, as this is wholly governed by Section 65A and 65B. The court held that these two sections, 65A and B, form a complete code when it comes to the admissibility of information contained in electronic record. And an electronic record by way of secondary evidence shall not be admitted unless the requirements under Section 65B are satisfied, including a written certificate in under Section 65B subclause 4. So this certificate that has been, you know, issued, what does it deal mainly with? If I'm just specifically focusing on 65B subclause 4 or even 65B, okay, it mainly focuses in terms of admissibility of digital evidence, but the digital evidence that is being considered is secondary, not primary. In order to make the secondary, that I'll come to that, don't worry, who will issue, right? Now, when it comes to the admissibility of that secondary digital evidence or secondary evidence which is in an electronic form, then over there a 65B certificate is required, which actually satisfy the conditions of Section 65B subclause 4. It was further held that the Evidence Act does not contemplate or permit proof of an electronic record by oral evidence if the requirements under 65B are not complied with. However, if an electronic record is used as primary evidence under the Section 62, the same is admissible in evidence without compliance with conditions specified in 65B. Right? So if primary evidence is a part which is playing a role, then it's not a part that is to be needed as a certificate, because the primary evidence itself is produced, you can say, as an evidence over there. Correct? Now, two decisions of Supreme Court deviated from position established in Anwar. So again, the conspiracy, it grew up, the debate went ahead, and there was some other in this, this another case over here. In Tommaso Bruno Supra, again, a three-judge bench of Supreme Court held that secondary evidence of contents of a document can be led under Section 65. However, in this judgment, the Supreme Court neither... Just a second, guys. I'm just getting a call. I'll just, you know, just a minute. Yeah, sorry for the interruption. Okay, so here we are. So, however, in this judgment, the Supreme Court neither relied on Section 65B subclause 4 and nor law laid down in Anwar Supra. Instead, Supreme Court relied on Navjot Sindhu Supra case, which was specifically overruled in Anwar. Again, you know, this, there was collision of these things. Thereafter, this is where you can say it came to, this conspiracy came to a conclusion, at least to a partial conclusion. That thereafter in Shahafi, I am audible, right? Yeah, it's going on. Yeah. Thereafter in Shafi Muhammad case, that was actually there, the Shafi Muhammad Supra again, the Supreme Court held that the requirement of producing a certificate in Section 65B, under the Section 65B subclause 4, is procedural and not always mandatory. Here, this statement is quite important. Producing a certificate, which certificate? 65B certificate, is not mandatory and it's procedural. A party who is not in possession of a device from which the document is produced cannot be required to produce a certificate under the 65B of subclause 4. The court was of the view that procedural requirement under Section 65B subclause 4 is to be applied only when electronic evidence is produced by a person who is in control of the said device and therefore in a position to produce such a certificate. Okay. However, if the person is not in possession of the device, Section 63 and 65 cannot be excluded. So what was the Supreme Court's decision? What were the clarifications that were came up with? Supreme Court overruled Tommaso Bruno and Shafi Muhammad Supra and clarified the position as follows. Again some clarifications. A certificate under Section 65B is mandatory and a condition precedent to the admissibility of the evidence by way of electronic record. The law laid down in Anwar need not to be revisited. However, the last sentence in the paragraph 24 of the said judgment reads, if an electronic record as such is used as primary evidence under Section 62, the same is admissible in evidence without compliance with the conditions in the Section 65B of the Indian Evidence Act, is to be read without the words under the Section 62 of the Indian Evidence Act. What it is, I'll just, as of now, this para, grab it as it is. The non-obstain language of Section 65B subclause 1 makes it clear when it comes to the information contained in an electronic record, the admissibility and the proof thereof must follow the drill of Section 65B, which is in special provision in this behalf. Again, 62 and 65 are irrelevant for this purpose. The requirement under Section 65B4, that is subclause 4, where the certificate is actually playing a role, is unnecessary if the original document itself is produced. Now, this is something which will actually is very easy to grab, right? You can just easily understand what it's trying to say over here. This can be done by the owner of a laptop, computer, tablet, even a mobile phone by stepping into the witness box and proving that the concerned device on which the original information is first stored is owned or operated by him. where a computer happens to be on a system or a network and it is impossible to physically bring such system or a network to the court, then the only means of providing information contained in such electronic record is in accordance with 65B subclause 1 to get together, combining with mandatory providing, compulsory generating and providing 65B certificate. Right, so this statement is actually very clear of. Oral evidence cannot suffice, and evidence attenuated cannot be given by a person in charge of a computer device in place of the requisite certificate, the under section 65B. So verbal evidence is not being, you can say, admissible. Where the requisite certificate has been sought from person or the authority concerned and the person or the authority concerned refuses to give such a certificate or does not reply to such demand, the party asking for such certificate can apply to the court for its production under the provisions of Evidence Act, the Code of Civil Procedure and or the Code of Criminal Procedure. Once such an application is made to the court orders or directs that the requisite certificate to be produced by the person to whom it sends summons in this regard, the party asking for the certificate has done all that he can possibly do to obtain the requisite certificate. The court observed that section 65B does not speak of the stage at which certificate must be furnished, such a certificate must be furnished to the court. In Anwar case, the court did not observe that such certificate must accompany the electronic evidence when same is produced in the evidence. Due to this, this requirement is applicable in cases where such certificate could be produced by person seeking to rely upon the electronic record. In cases where either a defective certificate is given or where such certificate has been demanded and is not given by the concerned person, the court must summon the person referred in the section of section 65B subclause 4 and require that the certificate be given by such persons. This ought to be done when electronic record is produced in evidence before the court without requisite of the certificate. In criminal cases, the requisite certificate can be directed to be produced by the court itself at any point of time, as long as the trial is not over and third party seeking is not concerned and third party is demanding the certificate yet, right? Whilst these observations were made in the context of criminal cases, the court noted that aforesaid is subject to exercise of the appropriate discretion in the civil cases. Given that the certificate under 65B subclause 4 may be given long after the electronic record has been actually been produced by the computer, it is insufficient that the certificate is either to the best of the issuer or the knowledge or belief. That's the reason, you know, I'll come to that. That's the reason, you know, this point actually, you know, deals with who can actually provide that the certificate. And I mean, all can do that, but there are some conditions, okay? The conditions under 65B2 and 65B subclause 4 must be satisfied cumulatively. In addition, aforesaid, the Supreme Court issued general directions to cellular companies, internet service providers to maintain call detail record. See, this is important. Why they were saying is because in upcoming lectures, we are actually going to have a look inside of the law enforcement techniques under the CRPC notice, 91 notice, right? So how it all actually came up, how they actually, you know, issue up this CRPC 91 notice. Why? Because the Supreme Court, due to the conspiracy going between the 65B was going on, then it was issued as a general direction to the cellular companies, to the telecom companies and the ISPs to maintain a CDR, call detail record and other relevant records for consent period in a segregated and a secure manner if such records is seized during the investigation in the relevant period. Concerned parties can then summon such records at the stage of defense evidence or in the event such data is required to cross-examine a witness. The Supreme Court clarified that these directions must be followed by courts that deal with electronic evidence to ensure the preservation of such evidence and the production of a certificate at the appropriate stage. The court found this necessary given the telephone and the ISP providers, internet service providers, are generally required to preserve and maintain electronic call and internet log records for a limited duration of 1 year. Right? A mandate. If the police or other individuals fail to secure those records or secure the records but to fail to secure the certificate within that period, the production of certificate issued after commencement of the trial would all in probably render the data unverifiable and admissible directly. An accused seeking to challenge the genuineness of the certificate under the Section 65B would be prejudiced as the electronic record may be missing. The Supreme Court was of the further view that appropriate rules and directions should be framed under the IT Act 2000, including the retention of data involved in the trial of offences, their segregations, their rules, chain of custody, the stamping and the record maintenance for the entire duration of the trials, appeals, and also in relation to the preservation of the metadata to avoid corruption. Appropriate rules for preservation, retrieval, and production of the electronic record should be framed after considering the report of the committee constituted pursuant to the conference of the Chief Justices held in April 2016. Right? Now, see over here again, if you can relate a few things that we have already previously discussed. This something is actually, you know, making some a mandate for the retention period, data retention period. In terms of dealing with the data retention period. Now, that if you just focus, I had mentioned about the Indus PDB bill, which is very closely inspired by GDPR. Okay, very closely influenced by GDPR. Indus PDB bill, which is yet to come, probably by the end of this year we are expecting. After that, there could be some certain assertions also, again to the privacy and the data concern, and for how long the data must be retained, how much data to be retained, about what is the actual data to be retained, again those sub clauses will again come under consideration, and you can still expect. I'm not sure, I'm just making a verbal statement as per my assumptions. We can still expect this change to revamp again in the coming years, probably next or the next year, after the you can say incorporation of PDB bill as an act. Correct? Because it directly deals with the retention of the data. This decision clears the air in relation to the conditions for admitting the electronic evidence under the Evidence Act. The directions issued by the Supreme Court for formulation of much needed to the data retention guidelines are welcome insofar if implemented, they will improve the efficacy of the criminal investigation proceedings. Right? Notably, the respondents in the present case were relieved of the mandatory obligation under 65B. Having taken all possible steps to produce the necessary certificate, which was to be given by third party over whom the responders had no control. The respondents in the present case made all efforts through the courts and otherwise to produce the requisite certificate from the authorities concerned, but the authorities willfully refused to provide the certificate. This equitable consideration afforded by the court in an otherwise rigid statutory scheme for the admissibility of the electronic records or digital evidence in evidence is also welcome. The court also observed that whilst the Section 65B is substantially derived from the Civil Evidence Act of the UK, English no longer distinguishes between computer generated evidence and other evidence. either qua of the admissibility or the attachment of weight to such evidence. So again some, if you can, you know, recall some previous classes, there is document again provided in the Edmodo, which I had said there will be test on it. I still remember, right? Let us just, you know, let's complete this few legal modules. We are going to have a test on this, right? As I said, even if not, then I hope actually you have actually went through this entire 24 pages, right? And I hope you find this completely amazing to read. That's the reason. See, again, it's getting added over here because it is inspired by UK's law. This is supplemented by concurring opinion of Justice V. Ramasubramanian, which undertakes the extensive analysis of the position in other jurisdictions, including the US, UK and Canada. It remains to be seen whether the observations in the present judgment are taken note of and implemented in the Evidence Act in the future. So it's here, it's added over here. So future, in the sense, again, I said that, again, I'm repeating the few points, that this is something which number one is we are going to discuss in more detail in the tomorrows or the probably the, how much lecture does it take? Probably till tomorrow it will be done, yet I am not sure, right? So depending upon the understanding and the capability and the pace at which we are going. Number two, these things, especially when it comes to the sections such as 65B and the mandates made under the 65B subclause 4 for the compiling with a 65B certificate. As of now, they are in existence. Not sure how much they will be re-amendment or they will be revamped in the upcoming year, especially this or the next year, due to the fact that various provisions are actually being undertaken even more. Number one is the PDB bill that is coming up in action. Number two, there is no such bill in action yet, but since lockdown, since the last year, 2020, there was some kind of informal announcements made by the electronics and telecommunication industry and all, wherein cyber policy, the implementation of cyber policy again into the nation of India and the associated treaties with the other countries will be given into a consideration, will be formulated, will be released as a bill, then as an act. Right, so these things will actually keep on adding and revamping of this thing that has been present over here. But as of now, it is very important to understand about this. Right, and I hope trust me, you can go and check on the internet. I had done this, you know, when I was preparing for, I mean, not preparing, but I was, you know, trying to collect article for these kind of things. This was the only website where I found this thing termed in such simple ways. Trust me, on other websites, you will find this entire references in a much more complicated and a complex way. And even if you will find it in an easy way, it won't be sufficient. It will be incomplete to actually make you understand that what it's all about, right? Hence the reason I chose this link over here. You can just, you know, go and research by yourself if you can find any alternate link that is highlighting on the same topic in a much layman terms. I'll be happy to share with others. I mean, it's a union work, right? You can start researching by yourself, but this is one of the most easiest links that I found on the net so far till today. So at least I hope out of so much of things that I've just, you know, said, at least 20-30% is somewhere adopted, is somewhere understood. Rest, I'll make sure that I'll make you understand in depth, right? Although I'm not in a way, or I'm not in a position to go and make you deep dive into the laws. Again, I'm saying we don't want to be a lawyer, but still I'll put some light in the next classes on this thing in a conceptual understanding way, discussing some case if possible, such as Anwar versus Bashir case that is being laid down in this article also. Right. So, and then we are going to see some of the Section 65B templates, and I'm going to tell you how you can write it, who can do it and all. And I have a lot of templates, I guess. I'm going to get a lot of templates. So I'll be happy to share all those templates with you. Although, again, it is in terms of the digital evidence, the electronic evidence, and its admissibility, and the digital evidence or the electronic evidence and its admissibility mainly deals with or complies with digital forensics and not much in terms of cybercrime, but more and much in terms of digital forensics. Yet it is important to understand, because we are studying about digital evidences. So considering the factors, admissibility and all those other things is quite important, right? Right. Anyone wants to put some light on something discussed? So I'll just open up the chat box. Am I audible? Please just let me know if I'm audible.
Yes, okay.
Cool. Anyone who wants to put some light or some questions, specific questions in terms of 65B certificate, again will be cleared in tomorrow's or the upcoming classes, right? Because as of now, to make some statements, it will lead to some more burdened up confusion. Just one thing I'd like to put in over here. I mean, just as in, just to, make you aware of the fact that every session won't be recorded, okay? It's actually against our company's policies. This is not the way our company actually works. We are primarily focused on live trainings, right? But yet, considering the complexity of the topic, we are actually recording. Otherwise, later on, I'm just making you all aware, okay? I'm not just, trying to, demotivate or something. I'm just trying to make you aware that in case if you're missing out some topics, expecting that the recordings will be provided. So sorry, I am not liable for that. Just considering the complexity of the topic that is ongoing, I just thought to record it. Okay, so Pirate sir, Sam sir, how did you felt? How much you were actually able to grab in? Yeah, not much fun. Yeah, it may be not much fun right now, but it is a very important concept. Okay, so then if it's all good for now, then we shall actually wind up the class. okay. Do you have a list of investigator activity? Sir, actually to be no. Why? Because there is no specific set of rules or, you know, specific set of activities, right? Depends on case to case. And even if such kind of guide is present, then it's not up to the marks of today's standards. Activity guide I won't be able to share, but investigator's guide I will be able to share. I'll look out for some. I think I have a few. Yeah, not activity guide actually, but not, it was, I think it's not activity guide, but in terms of investigator's handbook or something like that. Yeah, I do have that. Just let me then, just need to check where I have saved it, or I'll just, you know, gather it up and share it with you. I need to just find it off, sir. I'll just share. Don't worry. Yeah, I'll share. I'll share something regarding to it. Don't worry. That is, I think, a part of covered in somewhere in the handbook also. I mean, there are freely available. I mean, there are handbooks of various countries or police departments online available. I have a few downloaded. I just need to find them. I just need some time to find of them. Anyways, once I'll find, I'll just send it. I mean, not even send it. I'll directly upload on Moodle itself. Not Moodle, Edmodo. Cool then. Okay, so that's all. And before, you know, leaving, one small announcement, you can say a good announcement from our company. We have completed almost the entire blueprint of digital forensic course, and within a few days we'll be happy to release it officially with you all also. So the cybercrime investigator course, you all know that, and you all have the actual courseware and the index module and the blueprint of the topics, right? Similarly, in a few days, we are actually going to come up with digital forensic course blueprint outline, and we'll be happy to share with you all, right? You can just, you know, incorporate those things after this particular training, in case if you are, you know, further interested to get your hands on into DFF, you know, digital forensics. Okay. Sam sir, CHFI is something completely dealing with in terms of forensic. And you see, again, I have been saying this point previously also, that CHFI, you can say, is a combination of different forensic areas, such as a part of Windows forensics, a part of Linux forensics, a part of this forensics, a part of that forensics. But it won't, yeah, as a certificate, it's way good, but it won't be able to provide you that specific speciality in associated field. It's just, you know, a sip taken from all those cup. Right, so that's the point. Let's, you know, wait for a few days. Let me just share, you know, digital forensic courseware with you. And I'm sure, especially Sam, sir, you'll absolutely love that. Okay. Anyways, then